Hey friends, welcome to the YouTube channel All About Electronics. So in the previous video, through qualitative analysis, we understood that how the differential amplifier rejects the common mode signal and amplifies the differential input signal. And through a qualitative analysis, we have also seen that when the differential input is very small, typically in the range of millivolt, then only this differential amplifier works in the linear region and amplifies this differential input signal. So in this video, through a large signal analysis, let us understand it in detail. Now, when we say a large signal, then the signal is typically much larger than the thermal voltage. And as you are aware, this thermal voltage Vt is typically around 25 millivolt. So in this large signal analysis, we will assume that this differential input signal is much larger than the thermal voltage. So let's say here Vin1 and the Vin2 are the two inputs of this differential amplifier. That means differential input Vid is equal to Vin1 minus Vin2, right? And let's say the voltage at this node is equal to Vp. That means if we apply the KVL around this transistor Q1, then we can say that this voltage VBE1 is equal to voltage Vin1 minus Vp, right? And similarly, around this Q2, we can say that voltage VBE2 is equal to voltage Vin2 minus Vp. And if you recall, then this collector current IC is the function of VBE. That means collector current IC is equal to IS times e to the power voltage VBE divided by VT, where this IS is the reverse saturation current and the VT is the thermal voltage. So for the transistor Q1, we can say that this collector current IC1 is equal to IS1 times e to the power voltage VBE1 divided by VT. And similarly, for this transistor Q2, we can say that collector current IC2 is equal to IS2 times e to the power voltage VBE2 divided by VT. Now here, assuming both transistors are matched, let us assume that this IS1 is equal to IS2. And if we just rearrange these expressions, then we can say that voltage VBE1 is equal to VT times natural log of IC1 divided by IS. Similarly, voltage VBE2 is equal to VT times natural log of IC2 divided by IS. Now, as we have just seen, this Vin1 minus VBE1 is equal to Vp. And similarly, this Vin2 minus VBE2 is also equal to Vp. So in this expression, let us put the value of this VBE1 and the VBE2. That means we can say that Vin1 minus Vt times natural log of IC1 divided by IS is equal to Vin2 minus Vt times natural log of IC2 divided by IS. So if we just rearrange this expression, then we can say that Vin1 minus Vin2 is equal to Vt times natural log of IC1 divided by IS minus Vt times natural log of IC2 divided by IS. Now this Vin1 minus Vin2 is nothing but the differential input voltage, right? That means from this we can say that this differential input voltage Vid is equal to Vt times natural log of IC1 divided by IS divided by IC2 divided by IS. That means differential input voltage Vid is equal to Vt times natural log of IC1 divided by IC2. So from this, now let us find the expression of this collector current IC1 or the IC2 in terms of this differential input voltage. So from this we can say that collector current IC1 is equal to IC2 times e to the power voltage Vid divided by Vt. So in this way, we got the expression of the collector current IC1 in terms of the differential input voltage. Similarly, let us find the expression of the collector current IC2 in terms of the differential input voltage. Now here, for the simplicity, let us assume that the alpha is equal to 0. Or in other words, the value of the beta for both transistors are very high. Now normally, this collector current IC is equal to alpha times emitter current. But here, assuming alpha is equal to 0, we can say that this collector current IC1 is equal to IE1 and the collector current IC2 is equal to IE2. And if you apply the KCL at this node, then we can say that this collector current IE1 plus IE2 is equal to IEE. So here, this current is the IE1 while this current is equal to IE2. And here we can say that IC1 plus IC2 is equal to IEE. So in this expression, let us put the value of this IC1. So by putting this value, we can get the expression of the IC2. That means IC2 times e to the power voltage VID divided by VT plus IC2 is equal to IEE. And if we further rearrange this expression, then we can say that this collector current IC2 is equal to IEE divided by 1 plus e to the power voltage VID divided by VT. And once again, by using this expression, we can find the expression of the IC1. That means if we put the value of IC2 in this particular expression, then we can get the value of the IC1. So putting the value of this IC2, we can write this collector current IC1 plus IEE divided by 1 plus e to the power voltage VID divided by VT, that is equal to IEE. Or if we further rearrange it, then we can say that this collector current IC1 is equal to IEE times e to the power voltage VID divided by VT divided by 1 plus e to the power voltage VID divided by VT. And if we further divide the numerator and the denominator by e to the power voltage VID divided by VT, then we can say that this collector current IC1 is equal to IEE times 1 divided by 1 plus e to the power voltage minus VID divided by VT. So in this way, we got the expression of the collector current IC1 and the IC2 in terms of the IEE and the differential input voltage. And here, let me just also write the expression of the IC2. That is, IC2 is equal to IEE times 1 divided by 1 plus e to the power voltage VID divided by VT. Now let us see the effect of this voltage VID on these two currents. Now when this voltage VID is much greater than VT, in that case, this term, that is e to the power voltage minus VID divided by VT, will be very small. And in that case, this IC1 is approximately equal to IEE. That means whenever this VID is much greater than VT, then this IC1 is approximately equal to IEE. And similarly, in case of the IC2, this e to the power voltage VID divided by VT will be very large. That means this IC2 will be approximately equal to 0. So we can say that when this voltage VID is much greater than VT, then this IC2 is approximately equal to 0. Let's say this VID is equal to 10 times VT, and typically this VT is equal to 25 millivolt. That means roughly this differential input voltage is equal to 250 millivolt. Or in other words, we can say that this input voltage Vin1 is 250 millivolt greater than this Vin2. That means whenever this VID is equal to 10 VT, then this e to the power minus VID divided by VT will be equal to e to the power minus 10. And roughly it is equal to 4.5 times 10 to the power minus 5. That means we can say that in that case, this IC1 is approximately equal to IE. Similarly, for this IC2, this e to the power voltage VID divided by VT will be equal to e to the power 10. That is roughly equal to 22,000. So in that case, this IC2 will be approximately equal to 0. That means whenever this VID is 10 times VT, then almost entire current IE flows through the transistor Q1. And in that case, the current through the transistor Q2 is approximately equal to 0. And the reverse is also true. That means whenever this VID is equal to minus 10 times VT, or in other words, when this Vin2 is 250 millivolt greater than the Vin1, in that case, this IC1 will be approximately equal to 0 and the IC2 is approximately equal to IE. So if we see the curve of this collector currents versus the differential input voltage, then it will look like this. That means whenever this differential input voltage is equal to 0, in that case, this IC1 is equal to IC2 is equal to IE divided by 2. That means whenever this Vin1 is equal to Vin2, in that case, this IC1 and the IC2 is equal to IE divided by 2. And whenever this differential input voltage is much greater than 10 times VT, then this IC1 is approximately equal to IE, and at that time, this IC2 is approximately equal to 0. Similarly, when this differential input voltage is much less than minus 10 times VT, then this IC2 is approximately equal to IE, and at that time, this IC1 is approximately equal to 0. So assuming this differential input voltage is much greater than 10 times VT, this collector current IC1 is equal to IE, and in that case, this IC2 is equal to 0. So in this condition, if we see the output voltage VO1, then this VO1 will be equal to voltage VCC minus IE times RC. And for the VO2, since IC2 is approximately equal to 0, this VO2 is equal to VCC. That means VO1 minus VO2, or the differential output voltage, is equal to minus IE times RC, right? On the other end, when this VID is much less than minus 10 times VT, then the entire current IE will flow through the transistor Q2. That means in that case, this IC2 is equal to IE and the IC1 is equal to 0. So in this condition, VO1 will be approximately equal to VCC, while the VO2 is equal to VCC minus IE times RC. So in this condition, if we see the differential output voltage, that is VO1 minus VO2 will be equal to VCC minus IE times RC. That is equal to IE times RC. That means, as you can see, depending on the differential input voltage, this differential output voltage will change between these two values. So this curve shows the change in the differential output with respect to the change in the differential input. And this curve shows the change in the output voltages with respect to the differential input. That means whenever this differential input is equal to 0, in that case, this VO1 and the VO2 is equal to VCC minus RC times IE divided by 2. But for the non-zero differential input voltage, the outputs will vary in this fashion. So as you can see, only for a very small differential input range, this collector currents and the differential output voltage is linearly proportional to this differential input. So for this differential amplifier to work in the linear region, this differential input voltage should be very small. Typically, this differential input should be less than VT by 2. That means whenever the differential input is less than 10 millivolt, at that time only, this differential amplifier will work in the linear region and it will amplify the differential input. But this linear range can be extended by adding the emitter resistor of the same value to the both transistors. But the disadvantage of this emitter resistor is that the differential gain of this differential amplifier will reduce. So in the next video, using the small signal analysis, we will find the differential and the common mode gain of this amplifier. And we will also see the effect of this emitter resistor on the gain of the amplifier. But I hope in this video, through a large signal analysis, you understood what should be the range of the differential input so that this differential amplifier works in the linear region and amplifies the differential input. So if you have any question or suggestion, do let me know here in the comment section below. If you like this video, hit the like button and subscribe the channel for more such videos.